Well, Jay Smoove, it's been 178 days now since LaMelo Parker was killed. A three and a half month old child, innocent, but obviously proven guilty that day, unfortunately, for whatever. Maybe being in the car with the man who was supposed to be his father, Smith. He wasn't. So therefore it made LaMelo a hostage, and now he is a dead hostage. And still, 178 days later, we don't know who killed this baby while he was surrounded by law enforcement. Just short of being in custody, of course, the car was immobilized and and the driver of that car was dead in water, literally. However, along with him, LaMelo was killed. I almost made a mistake and say lost his life. No, he wasn't. He didn't lose his life. You know, there were protests over the weekend on Saturday. Black Lives Matter, Leah Campbell, and the Mississippi Rising Coalition, and others.
Hey, that's Mississippi.
Here's what it sounded like.
Mississippi Rising Coalition, along with other social justice groups, gathered at the corner of Highway 90 and 49 in Gulfport, demanding answers in the death of three-month-old LaMelo Parker. Parker was the innocent life lost at the end of a 100-mile-plus police chase on I-10 from Louisiana to South Mississippi in May. People there today say they want transparency and accountability. Jasmine Lotz has more.
Black lives matter. LaMelo's life mattered. Protesters like Leah Campbell have these signs to show they want their questions answered.
We still don't know whose bullet killed LaMelo. We've got no answers from any of the law enforcement agencies involved as to why they responded like they did.
Parker's father, Eric Smith, kidnapped him. And with the baby in the car, he took officers on a 100-mile police chase on I-10 from Louisiana to South Mississippi in May. Once the chase ended, officers opened fire on the car.
Oh my God.
Authorities say Parker lost his life from a bullet wound.
That had been a white baby, but it was a lot different.
I was horrifying. I watched the bystander video. They fired shots into the car. There were no attempts at de-escalation, no attempts to preserve life. It was unacceptable.
No matter the age, protesters grabbed their signs. And bullhorns at the corner of Highway 90 and 49 to demand answers.
There was some sort of gunfire exchange between LaMelo's father, who was inside the car, and officers who were outside the car. That's not confirmed. We need body cam footage and dash cam footage.
Protesters picked the spot to be seen and heard. But along with camera footage and the reason as to firing shots from all agencies, protesters want Gulfport Police Chief Chris Ryle to release the names of officers placed on leave.
The good it would do, it would bring closure to the LaMelo Parker family, who's experienced, a traumatic, loss. During this time.
We know we're up against a power structure, so we're strategizing and we're looking at this as just the next step in a long-term campaign.
In Gulfport, Jasmine Lux, WLOX, News Now.
All right, Jasmine, look at that. How about that? Look, Jasmine. I was there just typically, ladies and gentlemen, whenever I attend something like this, it's at a distance. Whenever Rip Daniels goes anywhere, then there are some who like Rip Daniels, there are some who don't like Rip Daniels, and Rip Daniels is well aware of that. And whenever I announce that I'm going to be somewhere, especially, doesn't mean that somehow or another I'm public enemy number one. It does mean that there are nuts out there. No, I'm sorry, they're not nuts. They are individuals out there who don't necessarily, who feel that Rip Daniels is the target. Rip Daniels won't be that. No, I won't be that. And the other thing is that you guys know how I feel about protest. I can tell you I'm not gonna take a sign, I'm not gonna take a Bible. So, you can interpret that however you want. However, I think that they are effective to draw attention. And my compliments to those who showed up. However, you need to do, and keep in mind, when you had protests in the past, of which I was part, between Jackson and Moss Point and New Orleans, there's always folks to look out for you. You know what I mean? There are some unsung heroes right here in Mississippi. If you were to read a book by, it's called We Shoot Back. A professor there in Georgia, actually, penned that book. We chatted with him. We need to reach out to him again.
Yeah, Emojo.
He really traces the steps of those individuals who were assisting both Medgar Evers and other protesters between Macomb and Jackson, really all the way up to Memphis. You know, as they were protesting, as they were marches, there were individuals who were marching alongside, but not part of the march. These were individuals who, like an individual by the name of Steptoe, who was a military veteran. He and others would knew quite well that although Megger and even SCLC was preaching nonviolence and certainly would not want to participate in the march and be armed. Of course, some may have been, I won't say. There was no doubt about the fact that there were individuals who were there who were, in fact, armed. No less than the Deacons for Defense in Bogalusa, Louisiana. And, you know, it's important that we tell our children this. It's important that young people have a tendency to think that, you know, there were Martin Luther King and others. And by the way, Martin Luther King owned a weapon as well. Yes, the preacher owned a weapon, a .38. Point is that, you know, there's a time and place for everything. But don't be no fool, you know? And these men, including one Megger Evers, were not fools. They were not fools at all. And they knew quite well that it was important to have individuals who would not participate in the protest directly, but would stand at a distance and watch and make sure that UCYA. I don't know if they do that on Facebook.
Not as much as they should.
Well, if you don't know what that is, call Roe and ask him. Look, before there was Facebook, there were some codes that we would use. Yeah, I'm just saying. So, yeah, it was, in that observance, it was obvious that there was some support by the passersby, but in other cases, there were individuals who had some other things to say. No doubt, there were those who wanted to make it into a support to police situation, and trust me on this, there's no doubt about the fact that the people who were there trusted the police. They didn't trust the policing. There's a big difference, you see. How you police is in as much as what you do. I mean, you got to have law enforcement in a civilized society. Leah Campbell and others know that. They know that. But policing is the activity that goes with, you know, protect and maintain the order. There is a standard by how you do that. Any professional officer knows this, and you follow those standards, no matter what. No matter what. If not, then when you have such a situation like this, law enforcement can become judge, jury, and even executioner. And that is what we don't want. Then we do become a police state. Some conservatives don't know what a police state is until it knocks on their door. What's been happening across this country as it applies to young African Americans has been exactly a police state. Do what I say, when I say, how I say, without regard for rights whatsoever. That's a police state. You know, speaking of execution, we had one over the weekend. You only hear about this on this show. I don't know why. You might hear a blurb here and there in some newscast, but you know, folks, if we're gonna execute folks and it's gonna be a deterrent, I mean, come on, we gotta tell you about it. You know, now we have the arduous task of having to tell you about it. By the way, Mississippi is doing a rehearsal for an execution coming up Friday. I'll tell you about it later. First, for the guy who was executed, so that it will serve as a deterrent for those of you who are contemplating or maybe even talk about killing someone. You know, as an aside, don't shine that on. You know, there is a piece about the city of brotherly love. Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, right now is in the grips of an incredible crime wave, shooting wave, actually. Children, literally, are having to be escorted from schools. In other words, the drive-by shooting and the shooting among high schoolers is such that it is, it's so horrendous that it, students are afraid to go home, walk home.
Can't even come to school. Student shot himself in the leg last week at school.
There's a reason for that too, by the way. There's a reason for that, and I'll probably get into it. But it's very, very serious out here. Very serious out here. So maybe by my sharing this, some young school-age individual will reconsider whether or not he wants to kill someone. Of course, there's in this state, I mean, you can get away with murder if you're a minor. I hate saying it that way. I mean, you're not going to get away, but I mean, you won't be executed. See the hands of those who think that 15, 16-year-olds should be executed. Your hand's not up.
No.
You don't think so?
Nah.
You don't think they know right from wrong?
Well, it's not that. I just don't think that they should be, eliminated from the possibility of learning from that grave mistake.
It's in the hands of those who think that the person that gave the 15, 16-year-old a handgun should be executed. Oh, your hand's up? Your hand's not up? Okay. My hand's up.
Gave them? Oh, yeah.
Well, gave them, sold them, look, however. I mean, a 15, 16-year-old can't buy a handgun.
Right.
How about that? I mean, what they did was they provided the weapon that was, you know.
Yeah.
Your hand's up now?
Yeah. Okay. I feel like they gave a weapon to a weapon at that point.
Yeah. It's going to be a long day, but not so for Willie B. Smith III. There were at least two others. This is Willie B. Smith III. Look at that. It looks like the man that was executed. I guess they could get a better picture than that. Let's see. Nope. I don't have a better picture than that. You want to know what happened to him? Well, he was executed. He was executed for murdering someone. He was. He was executed on Thursday there in Bama. There was overwhelming evidence that, well, that he had some intellectual disabilities. I'll let you decide. The jury didn't decide upon that. It was a unanimous jury for him to be found guilty. In Alabama, it's got to be unanimous, right? But it's not unanimous when it comes down to whether he deserved execution. How about that? It was a 10-2 vote. Did you know that that Mississippi is the only state that still allows death sentences imposed by not a unanimous jury? You didn't. Now you do. So 10 out of the 12 people said that old Willie B. Smith III should be executed. Two of the jurors said, no, we don't think so. Maybe he should spend life in prison. This is the guy that wanted to have his pastor hold his hand. His pastor was going to hold his hand, too, while he was given that lethal dose of, of drugs. And, of course, they said, nah, can't let you do that. And then there was this. They held it up. They held up the execution because Alabama, along with two other states, I'll let you guess which two that would be, have now come up with a new method of executing. I'm sure you kids can't wait, can you? You're so macabre. You guys really want to know, don't you? Especially you guys who are contemplating killing someone. I hope, anyway. Maybe it will change your mind. Now you can be suffocated. Now they don't take a pill and put it over your head. They take nitrogen, like the kind I've got out there in the transmitter room. Do you know that our air, you think you're breathing H2O, because it doesn't say in, you think it's not in the air. Well, do you know that the majority of what you breathe is nitrogen? Did you know that? You probably didn't. Now you do. I use it basically as just a clean kind of, what would you call it, air, I guess, to maintain the coax. Nevertheless, they take the nitrogen, and they allow you to breathe that. But the nitrogen doesn't have oxygen. You see, without the oxygen, then it's just nitrogen. You will die. You will suffocate. And I want you to know, the authority says it's painless. Of course, none have come back to say.
Yeah, who reported on that?
I'm just saying, they said it's painless, bro. You got to take the word for it. Nobody, man, they don't have no.
And brought him back, and it was like.
Well, no, they didn't.
Did that hurt?
No, they didn't.
Did that hurt?
No, they didn't say that.
That didn't hurt.
So there was a. They held up the court as well because he was. His attorneys argued that he did not have the cognitive skills, the intelligence to understand the difference between lethal injection and dying by oxygen. Well, they just didn't hold much in, so therefore they got on with it. Mm-mm-mm. Oklahoma, the only state other than Alabama to have publicly discussed plans to use the nitrogen. However, Oklahoma and Mississippi now is authorized nitrogen. How about that? You got a choice. You kill someone and you get, it's a capital crime, you got a choice. Lethal injection, it's not going to be phenobarbital. Or nitrogen. How about it? No gas chamber. By the way, I want you to know Arizona now just announced they've refurbished their gas chamber. So now they can gas you. And they're going to use cyanide gas, the same kind of gas they used on Jewish there in Germany. Does that sound horrible to you? It's execution. And hopefully by doing so, we won't have a reason to do that. However, it is what it is. Back to Smith's last few hours here. Any last words, bro?
No last words.
No last words. Well, let's see. What did he eat? Let's see here. He had barbecued potato chips, some M&Ms, and he washed it down with a Coke. How about that?
He was said to have refused breakfast, lunch, and his final meal.
He lost his appetite.
Makes sense.
Why?
Why?
Why would it make sense that he lose his appetite?
Well, because he's not going to eat anymore.
I mean, you understand, ladies and gentlemen, this man has been incarcerated on death row for almost, 20 years? What was he convicted of and sentenced to die for? You really want to know? All right, then I'll tell you so that maybe you won't do the same. I mean, that is what serving as a deterrent is. You'll learn from this example. He was killed for abducting Sharmer Ruth Johnson at gunpoint. She was at a cash machine back in 1991, first, you got to understand what he got from her. He got from her $100. He got $100. That's what he got. And put her in the trunk. Then he found out something that, boy, he was not a good idea. Found out that she was the sister of a police officer. The final moments of her young life, Mr. Smith, after learning that Johnson was a law. I gave out too much. She was related to a police officer. I bet she was a sister. Just said she was related. I want to make sure I get it right. And they don't want to let that information out, more than likely, primarily because there could be some folks retaliated, I don't know, after 20-something years. So on the final moments, he put Johnson in the trunk of a car and then decided to take the shotgun and put it to her head. Yeah, as you guess, he blew her brains out. And that wasn't good enough. He had the he had the intelligence to realize that even by doing so, you still had some evidence. So he set the car on fire. Burned the body to a crisp in an effort to try to cover the fact that he had killed her and had robbed her. Didn't work. I don't see the evidence, though. That was the biggest thing, but it never was really a great, great argument. His greatest problem was he did not admit it. He should have admitted it. Had he admitted it, then maybe he would have gotten off. That's usually the thing, and that's also the reason why I don't favor the death penalty. All you gotta do is admit you killed somebody, and then, you know, they let you off. And in my view, who else deserved to be put to death? You know what I mean? I'm trying to give a little chuckle here. I know in this very horrible situation, it's difficult. But that is that's the contradictions in our judicial system, ladies and gentlemen. Well, he was, in fact, put to death. Any last words, Ro?
None.
No last word?
No last word.
So they applied the lethal injection, and that, as they say, was that. All right, you want to give him a bell? You have to think about the bell? Bell? Three beller. So what brought that up?
He didn't get a meal, so get him an extra bell.
Really?
Yeah.
I think that's cruel. I think that's cruel and inhumane reaction to it.
Did I give him an extra bell? It's cruel.
All right, folks, don't take it out on us. We just want to make sure you remember it and hopes and share it with your children, too, because it seems as though they're killing each other at a clip, just saying. Not being funny breaks my heart, but it does. Well, it won't be. It's going to be broken again this Friday in Mississippi.
Yep.
Now, if anybody deserves it, this guy does, and even he said so.
Oh, he did admit to what he's accused of?
Oh, yeah, he is. Well, he'd be way beyond that. David Neil Cox.
The name of the condemned?
David Neil Cox. He pled guilty in 2012 and wondering why he is still alive.
What did he do?
He killed his wife, Kim. I should save the details. We normally don't give this until actually he's executed.
Well, he doesn't say how he did it.
I'm not going to give you the details. We'll wait for the execution. It didn't sound like going to a public hanging. Don't you think that Cindy Hingham Highsmith would love this part of my show? I want you to take this and send it to her. Of course, I'm not inviting her because that's what she said. If she was invited to a public hanging by the guy. She probably wouldn't want to come because I'm doing it, huh? She doesn't like me, you know.
Well, yeah.
I don't know why.
Well, did you endorse her?
She is my senator.
Did you endorse her?
I did not.
If he invited me to a public hanging, I'd be on the front row.
I need to clear that up a little bit. That's a little too tinny for me. So, Cox is going to meet his end this. I can tell you this. Not only does he say he deserves to die and fired his lawyers and now has been taken to court, he also said this. Well, he killed his wife. And he'd kill her again.
Damn.
I know you can't wait.
I'm excited now.
I know you are.
That's strange.
I know you are. All right, folks. Don't you like Mondays to start off this way?
Get a new chance. Fresh start.
This is the American system, though, you know. It really, really is. And we are the most civilized nation in the world. We really, really are. Because of this. If you're going to maintain freedom, then there has to be the ultimate penalty for denying someone else their freedom. Look, this still is an experiment, one could argue, but there are those who would say it's effective. Yeah, right, sure. Let me tell you how ineffective it is. Hang on. Just so you'll know how this is not so effective. There has been, since the death penalty was reinstated. See, I came along when the death penalty was stopped because of cruel and inhumane treatment. The death penalty was reinstated, 1976. A little brief hiatus there. And during that hiatus, you'd be surprised to know that, really, the murders did not increase. Did you know that?
When there was no death penalty?
Absolutely. You would think with the death penalty, the murders, and when the Supreme Court said it's cruel and inhumane treatment, you would have thought that now the murders, everybody who ever wanted to murder somebody would murder someone.
Yeah, no deterrent.
No? Wrong. When you compare the numbers before 1976 to the numbers after 1966, there's been 1,537 condemned prisoners who have been put to death. And the murder rate jumped, particularly between 1984 and 1994, way beyond where it was.
Whilst no death penalty is in effect.
Absolutely, absolutely positively. Overwhelmingly, the punishment, those who were executed were overwhelmingly poor and they were working class. Notice I said poor and working class. Many of these folks had a job. They were poor, they were working class, and then ethnic minorities were disproportionately represented among all of them. So what I'm saying to you, America, this great system of mine, this great experiment, we have to evaluate whether or not it's effective. This whole death penalty thing with the deterrence, as opposed to trying something else like, I don't know, stopping the killer before the killer decides to do it. We always Johnny come lately with that. Notice I didn't say the police. For good reason, because usually they come thereafter, only because we don't call them before. We have to be good stewards of each of us, is my point, ladies and gentlemen. That's my point. All right, let's see. It's Friday, it's Monday, which means we get caught up on all the stuff that happened the weekend. Speaking of protests, there was another protest over the weekend.
Yep.
Man, these folks. What do you do with these people?
I stay away generally if I can.
By the way, that last protest, the last piece was from LOX. You got another piece. This is from the protest at the corner there of. And by the way, it was not only here. They had it also all over. It's in many state houses. They had protests of vaccines.
Yeah, well, the mandate of these vaccines, this reporting also from Jasmine Lott, gathered and go forth to stand in solidarity against the COVID-19 vaccine mandates. The group says it's disappointed with employers facing people to either risk getting the vaccine or risk losing their job. Jasmine Lott has more.
Testers gathered here at the corner of Highway 90 and Courthouse Road to express medical freedom against COVID-19 vaccine mandates. They say it is not up to the government to control your health, so they're here to express their thoughts today. Organizers say that they chose to gather here because the intersection is busy. They say they want as many cars seeing them as possible and are happy that there are several honks showing support. The group brought signs saying medical freedom and my body, my choice. People here say they want to show that there are safe spaces for those who do not want to take the vaccine.
It's not so much anti-vax, it's anti-mandate. Nobody needs to be told what to put in their body. We should all have a choice, and that is the definition of freedom, and that is the definition of our country. What they're doing right now is wrong. This government is killing this country, and we need to stand up for what we believe in, and that is freedom.
The protest here ends at 2 today, but there will be another one on November 5th at the Biloxi Lighthouse, and organizers here invite the public to come. In Gulfport, Jasmine Lott, WLOX News Now.
I also watched that at a distance, just kind of cruised over, just kind of looked. And this, it's an amazing thing. There was this guy that passed by in a white Mercedes, and he screamed out, "Nuts!" I looked at the back of the tag and it had Doc on it. "Nuts!" Look, I'm not laughing at you. I'm laughing at him. I get it. I get what you're saying, but there is no mandate right now. The government has not mandated. I would hope that you would protest, let's see, COVID. Really, you know the culprit behind all of this is COVID now, ladies and gentlemen. And that's something you guys just can't grasp. And you can't grasp it because you're not supposed to, because the Trumpican down there in Mar-a-Lago had told you that it's not. It's just going to go away. Look, I was Johnny come lately to get a vaccine because I wanted to wait until after it was a year just to get a feel. But when people around you and you know someone who has died of COVID and gotten COVID and it did not fare well for them, I want you to ask yourself something. What's the chance of your surviving? And do you really want to get that sick? It's okay. You don't believe it. I don't get the flu vaccine. I don't, because the flus are not as lethal or not as lethal as COVID. It's a lot more lethal, ladies and gentlemen. And it's getting worse, to be quite frank. I think that there are those individuals out here who are taking their attack to the wrong people. It is not government. It really isn't. Government's not killing over 700,000 people. Of course, it was the lack of government that resulted in that number being so big. I do blame Trumplican Donald John. I certainly do. For misleading deliberately the public and allowing it to spread. The more it spreads, the more lethal it becomes. You got me? Sort of like a trickle rolling down Mount Everest, right? If not stopped, that trickle then becomes a stream. And then before you know it, the trickle becomes a torrent. And all of a sudden, Tanzania is flooded. LaRusha, what is it? I'm trying to think of the name of that place I was in. I can't think of it. It'll come to me. I mean, when you see Mount Everest, you don't understand, ladies and gentlemen, there's ice on Mount Everest. And look, listen to me. I was in the waterfall. It was Kilauea waterfall. You climb down and then climb back up. And trust me, both ways, it's challenging. Cold as ice water. But the point is that trickle spreads. And then you have a torrent. That's what we have. And that's what we had. And so for these people to actually feel that, okay, it's government that's killing folks, it's not government killing folks. I'm just going to tell you now. If, in fact, you want to protest anything, go to COVID House. Or protest, you're spreading it. How about that? They weren't wearing masks either. Oh, you think that's something? And wait till you hear about the Surgeon General in Florida. He's a Negro, too. Can you believe? Well, I guess you can. We'll be back.
The holidays are coming and Memorial is committed to stopping the spread of COVID-19.